Well, respect of how the week has been, we are here today just to give thanks to God and show appreciation for all that He's done and all that He's doing and all that He will do. And so in light of that, I just want to welcome you. Today is your first time of just coming here. This is Hadewood Community Church. We meet here every Sunday, you know, and we meet online on Wednesday, which I will give more information about later. So can we just pray, please? Father, we thank you for this beautiful day that you have made for us to see, to rejoice, and to be glad in it. We thank you for the gift of life, and we thank you, O God, that we have the privilege of knowing you. Lord, we pray as we gather here today that you will come to our midst and just help us to understand you and express ourselves through the songs that we're going to sing, through the words that we're going to hear from you. And you give us the strength and courage, and give us, oh God, the willingness as well to want to do your will at all times. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. We start with a song that says, Lord, I lift your name on high. And this is a song that means so much to me, because some of the words there, like the one that says, I'm glad you are in my life. I'm glad you came to save me. You came from heaven to earth. After that, we're going to sing, Blessed Be Your Name. And it's a song that's, like I said, as well, it means so much to me. Because it says, in a land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow, blessed be your name. And the next one talks about, when I'm found in a desert place, it's a lonely place, a dry place, or when I walk through the wilderness, it says, blessed be your name. We're simply saying the good time and the bad time, blessed be your name. Let's just rise up and take a first one.
Yes. raspberry off of a strawberry plant. It just doesn't work that way. And the other thing I want you to think about is, if I pick an apple and it's this tiny and it's not even got the proper color on it yet, is that apple going to keep growing and growing into a nice juicy fruit if I've already picked it off of the tree? No, the only way that it grows into this beautiful fruit is if it's connected to the tree. So why did he tell us all of this? Well, there's something called the fruit of the Spirit. And when we're connected to Jesus and when we're in Jesus, we can the Holy Spirit produces in us beautiful fruit that reflects Jesus. It doesn't reflect nasty things. It reflects beautiful things. But I'm just going to stop there because I think I've butchered it enough. We have a little video, but when I go out with the kids, don't worry, it'll be much better. But all you adults, just remember, you can only get the fruit that is connected to that certain type of fruit, and that's the same thing for us as Christians. So we'll watch this video, and then Austin will let us know when the children can go out for, people who are in primary school can go out for kids talk.
I'm sure there's enough message for today. And like he said, that the first fruit there is love. We're going to take this song that says, "Your love is amazing." And after that, we'll take the second song, which is the heart of worship. And when it says your love is amazing, it's unchanging. It's a mountain. Your love is a mountain, firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery. And I pray that as we take those two songs, God give us a heart of worship. After then, Ryan's going to come up here and just do his things. Thank you.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! See what we did while we were there. I'll give a little recap before we do our sermon for today, all right? Cabin, they went to the cabin. They said go to bed, they went to bed. We thought they had a fever. Some of them did. But we had a great time. We really appreciate the prayers, and we really appreciate those from our congregation that ended up being able to provide a way for some of the kids to go that wouldn't have been able to go otherwise. And so that was a great encouragement. It was a great time together. We look forward to next year when we can do it. We do like the fact that, as you can see, when they talk about the night games and everything else like that, when I say it's pitch black, we have not a single light on that whole place. But because of all the glow sticks, they're able to have so much fun because their eyes adjust and they end up doing something. They're going, this is cool. And the place that we went this year, we want to try to go back next year too because they've done so much to improve it. That was like the coldest weekend we had so far. And a lot of these crazy kids jumped in the pool. So you need to pray for their mental health at this point because some of them have serious issues. Only Chris would be like, oh, it's warm. No, the pool was freezing. But they had a great time and they got to hear from Andy, who is from another church. And just be praying for our young people. Each Sunday night we have rally up at Slade. We still do our youth together with Slade. And we'd love to see as many from our church down here go up and be a part of that. So every Sunday night, we're up there. We'll be up there tonight. So if you have a young person, bring them up. If you don't know where it is, ask me. I'll give you the address. And we'd love to have that time together, all right? Before we get into today's sermon, let's just have a word of prayer again. Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you put it on the hearts of people like Paul to write down things in a way that come to life off the pages, that we can see and picture exactly what it is that you are wanting for us. We thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, I grew up in South Florida, and so one of the things about growing up in South Florida is you have to get used to things like this. Anybody know what that is?
Hurricane.
Hurricane. Anybody heard of a hurricane lately? In the last little bit? Yeah. It literally went through the state that I grew up in. And my brother-in-law, he works for the power company in the state and everything. And when they use words like, okay, there's 2 million people without power, you begin to understand the scale. And then he says, and we can't count this area because that area is literally gone and we have to completely rebuild the infrastructure. And you begin to understand the scale of things. I didn't understand the importance of roots and root systems until 1992. I was 12 years old and we had the first major hurricane that we ever had in my lifetime. And it was called Hurricane Andrew. It was on the 24th of August. I always joke with my mother-in-law because that's also her birthday. And I said, well, that's the second natural disaster we had on that day. She doesn't give me good looks after that. And she's not going to watch this, so I'm safe. But in that day, we learned why roots are so important. Because what happens is, when you see roots like this, you think, oh, this is a good, healthy tree. You couldn't be further from the truth when it comes to surviving a storm. And the reason for that is very simple. There's a lot of these roots, but they're not very deep. You quickly found out after Hurricane Andrew that there were certain types of trees that came from somewhere else. They were all the ones that were laying down. And the ones that were native to the area were the ones that were still standing up. So you had things like this. And when I show you this picture, I want you to understand, if I was standing up next to this, I would reach about here. And we saw this all over the place. In fact, we even had fatalities after Hurricane Andrew because park workers trying to cut limbs and stuff like that and vehicles hitting the wrong root and it would sit the tree back up and it crushed people. So when we look at these roots, we have to understand that the root systems either go down deep. Because if they don't, you have this. But one thing you don't see too often is palm trees on their side. Palm trees have a different kind of root system. They go deep first, and then they get as dense as possible to hold the ground as well as it can. Usually, if you see a palm tree that is down after a hurricane, it's because literally the trunk snapped. But you don't see many of them with the roots that came up with it. Because they were made for that climate. They were made for that area. And so what we have to do is think of what kind of root system do we want to have in our lives, in our walk. Now, if anybody's ever watched a Western film, inevitably, right when the gunfight's going to happen, you got one of these things that just kind of rolls through the picture. It's not an exaggeration. Tumbleweed literally does that all over the Midwest of the U.S. and stuff like that. And the reason is very simple. You look and you think, okay, that's pretty big size. And understand, when that one right there on that road is probably about this big. You think, oh, that's a pretty good size thing. But the problem is tumbleweed has one solitary small root right there dead in the center, and it only goes down about 4 centimeters. And so basically it gets to the point where it absorbs so much wind that then all of a sudden that little root just gives up and it just starts rolling away. This is exactly what Paul is trying to warn us against being like in the passage that we're going to be looking at today. Because he wants us to remember that roots connect the tree to the source of nourishment. They keep it strong and able to sustain the growth of all that trunk and leaves and stuff like that that we see. So that's what I want us to think about today. I want us, as we look at this passage, to think of that root system like the palm tree that goes deep, that goes thick, and then it's able to grab hold because it's gone down into the nourishment that it needs from the soil. Okay? Let's go through this passage together. And if you look at it, you'll see I highlighted a few bits because there's a pattern that I want us all to see. It says, so then, just as you received Christ, Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition, and of the elemental spiritual forces of this world rather than on Christ. For in Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, and in Christ you have been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority. In him, you were also circumcised with a circumcision not performed by human hands. Your whole self, ruled by the flesh, was put off when you were circumcised by Christ. Having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through your faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead. When you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross, and having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Now, I want us to remember here that when Paul is writing this, he's writing this to people who have accepted Christ Jesus as their Savior. Because that's so important, because you can't be talking about being in Christ if you didn't accept Christ. So he's saying, this is the church. I'm trying to challenge you. I'm trying to get you to focus on what the center point always was. He wants them to remember that because they started at the source, they need to continue in that source to receive the nourishment and the fullness that is in him. Now I want you to see, how many times did we see where it says in him or by Christ or with Christ? I mean, this is a serious amount in this time. And this is the key towards it all, being in Christ. He is the focal point. He is the center point of it all. When we look at this part, it says, so then, just as you receive Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. Is that always easy? If you don't think it's easy, raise your hand. Sometimes. Be honest. The reason I'm asking is some people are like, do I answer yes? Do I not? But the reason I want us to see is that all of us are going to struggle at some point. All of us will struggle at some time. It doesn't change who Christ is. It doesn't change what he's done for us. I had to think through that as I was preparing this sermon this week. I was talking with Verna outside. And I said, she said, how are you? And I said, well, this has been one of those weeks where you have to, before you can get up here, you have to talk it through to yourself first. Because sometimes we forget where we are rooted and where we should be rooted. The fact is, we'll always be growing roots. The question is, where will we connect those roots to? And so Paul's sitting here telling us, look, this is where you need to be, rooted in him. I also looked at the New Living Translation, and it said like this, and now just as you accepted Christ Jesus as your Lord, you must continue to follow him. Let your roots grow down into him, and let your lives be built on him. I just love the way that it's slightly different, but it kind of helps my brain make that picture of letting our roots grow down into him, like those palm trees go down into the ground so they can have the strength and the sturdiness that is provided by the nourishment of the source that we need. If we're not connected to the right source, we may see those roots kind of like that first tree, that they go out, but they're very, very shallow. Because what we do is we start letting our roots go into the things that aren't going to nourish us. We let our roots start growing out into things of this world that may be a mile wide, but they're only a couple centimeters deep. And that's never going to benefit us because it's not going to get us the nourishment that we need in our lives. We'll end up like that tumbleweed that gets easily knocked over and begins to roll around with every wind of change that happens in our culture and our society. Let me ask you a question. Do you think our culture and society is the same today as it was 20 years ago? About 50 years ago? It gets more drastic as we go back in time, right? And some people say, well, we've learned more. No, we haven't. People still do dumb stuff every day. If we learned and we truly evolved, we wouldn't have crime. We wouldn't have all the pain and suffering that we have. But the truth is this, it's because of the sin in the world that we have what we have. There's nothing new under the sun. So the same thing that was true when Paul wrote this is the same thing that's true now. It's all in where we connect ourselves to. But if we walk in the truth that is Christ, our roots grow down deep. We get the nourishment that we need. And what Paul's trying to point out is here to these guys, remember, you have the Gnostics who have come in and tried to tell them, no, it's Christ plus something, to take them to another level. And he's going, no. Christ is the center point. Christ is everything. Christ is where you started and where you stay and grow. And that is where you need to be. And that's when he says, you know, be rooted and built up. Rooted is so important because we have to make sure that we're going to the right place, which is Christ. He needs to always be the center point. We were talking in our growth group this week, and I have it's called the Jesus-Centered Bible. And I know a lot of you guys, if you have a Bible that's got the red letters in it and stuff like that in the New Testament, that's all the red letters of what Jesus had said in the New Testament, stuff like that. But this Bible goes back, and in the Old Testament too, it's got blue letters for all the things that talk about Christ and prophesy Christ in it, so you can see the thread that goes from Genesis to Revelation throughout the whole thing. He is the center point of it all. He is the source of nourishment and nutrients that we need. Paul then goes and gives us the second part of the picture to drive the point home. He says, I want you to be rooted and built up. Has anybody ever gone by a building site and seen something like this? So much of what's important to the building starts below ground. It starts in a place that most of the time, once that building is built, you will never see it. There was a pastor friend of ours in Peru, and one of the elders was an architect. And he said, Pastor, what we need to do is we need to make sure we go 6 meters deep, not 3 meters. And he said, but we only have enough money to do the ground floor. He said, yeah, but you want to build for what you know God can do later. because if they did 6 meters deep for the foundation, then they could be built up higher and higher, and they could have a multi-story building. And so what he's doing is he's sitting there going, you say, Pastor, look, this foundation is the key to everything. If our foundation is solid in Christ, imagine what God can build on top of it. But if you have a building that has the wrong foundation, ask anybody who's ever done any building works and stuff like that. If the foundation has a fall, what happens to the building? It will fall at some point. You'll start to see visible signs. You'll start to see in the wall, all of a sudden there'll be a crack going down the wall, and you're going, what happened there? It's all because of what was under in the foundation. That is key. And as we're going to Christ and stuff like that, he's adding all of this steel in there before the cement is poured. That way we're strong in him. The strength comes from him. The nourishment comes from him. The building up comes through him. And that's what Paul's trying to drive home here. He's like, hey, you know, I need you guys to be built up and to grow. But why? So that our faith will grow, so that we will be overflowing with gratitude and thankfulness. Funny enough, I've been going through a devotional thing, and he happened to be covering this passage too, but his thing was all on joy and thankfulness. I'm like, well, that's not really the angle I'm talking about as we look at the whole book and everything, but it really challenged me. Because if we're rooted and built up in Christ, then being overflowing with thankfulness should be evident in our lives. And he's like, when one of the things he pulled out was, you know, when have you been thankful for the hard times? When have you told the Lord thank you when you're in the midst of a storm? And it started challenging me because there's some parts that have become the focus lately for me in my life, and it wasn't the focus on Christ or the thankfulness I should have in him. It was more worried about my health stuff and different things like that. And so when he said, when have you thanked God for your biggest struggle? I'm like, so you're telling me I need to thank God for my diabetes? It's kind of counterintuitive in my brain. But then as I'm thinking about it and praying about it, it helps me rely on him more on a day-to-day basis and understand that he is the one that's in control. And I should be thankful for that. Because if I'm not, then I'm not allowing him everything to work with. I have to make sure that my heart is focused on him so that he can do everything he can, which is more than I could ever imagine. As it says in Ephesians 3:20. So it's so important that we see this thankfulness overflowing in our lives. And that will show us that we are being rooted and built up, and our roots are connected to the right source. Now here's what I don't want you to do. If you've been struggling and you don't feel very thankful, and you feel like this isn't a thing to beat you down, this is a thing to go, okay, let's refocus our eyes on Christ. And the great thing is this: if you look around, God has given us a church body and a church family to help us kind of reset our sights sometimes. Have you ever said something to somebody that later somebody says the same thing to you, and that's when you realize, oh, I guess I should listen to what I said to somebody else before? It just kind of helps us click a little bit and go, okay. That's the wonderful thing about having a church family that we're walking along the journey with. Because if we have that, then God's going to use us, like Jeff said last week, to admonish and encourage and to build up. And that's so important. And that can't happen unless we are connected both to Christ, but connected to the body as well. These things build on top of each other. And that's why God put it together in that way, so that we would have a community to grow and love. In our walk, we're always going to be moving. Sometimes we'll be moving forward and growing, and sometimes we'll be sliding backwards. There is no in-between in our walk with Christ. You ever notice that when maybe you're not spending that quiet time in God's Word and spending our time in prayer, that we're still moving? The truth is, we start to slide. We slide backwards. We begin to notice that we're doing things that we shouldn't be doing, or saying things in a way we shouldn't be saying it, or focusing our minds and our hearts on things that are not helpful. And in those times, that's when we can reach out and say, hey, can you just pray for me about this situation? Find someone that you can connect to and say, hey, maybe we can read this same book together and study together, and then we can talk about it. This is how God has given us this wonderful thing of being rooted and built up, but then having someone else next to us that is being rooted and built up with it. We see multiple times that Paul talks about rejoicing in the suffering, or remembering why he's in the chains that he's in, and that's because of Christ. Anybody's ever read through all of Paul's letters, we know that Paul really had some hard times. Yet he's able to focus on being thankful. When they were beaten in Philippi, they were singing praises. It's hard to sing praises sometimes when you feel like you're getting beat down. But this is the cool thing. When we see in Scripture that Paul was a real guy, and we see his flaws, and we also see how God worked in his life, that tells us, hey, he can do the same thing in us. Why is it so important that we be rooted and built up? Because if we aren't rooted in Christ, we will become weak and susceptible to stumbling and being persuaded to follow things that are not what Christ said. The next verse, he says, see to it that no one takes you captive through hollow or deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world rather than Christ. We always have to go back to Scripture. It does not matter who is standing up here preaching or leading or talking. Whatever is set up here has to be gone back to Scripture and say, is this right? Is the way it's being taught, is the way it's being said, is it right? If we don't know Scripture, then we'll begin to believe things that are not right, because what will happen is they'll sprinkle a little bit of Scripture on top without context. And then all of a sudden, they can say whatever they want to say. I've seen some guys that are online that they get a big following. And it's sad, because if you listen to them for 10 minutes and you know Scripture, you know they are way off. Just because a bunch of people follow someone doesn't make them right. As I was reading one of the commentaries, I was talking about this guy who wrote the commentary, him and some of his friends one time, as a joke, him and about 15 friends, they stood on a street corner, and they all began just looking up at nothing. And they were like, no, that's, is it? And they just started having a little conversation. As people walked by, what do you think people started doing? They started looking. They get their head. And little by little, as more people in the crowd gathered, him and his friends began to step out. And then they stood at a distance for about 30 minutes. And people kept joining the crowd, looking up. And then the people who had been there the longest began to walk away and say, yeah. But people are literally staring at nothing. We tend to do things like that if we're not grounded in what is right. We can start looking at the wrong thing because we haven't looked at Scripture to see what it says. Last time I checked, Chris, Jeff, and myself are not perfect. We're far from it. Each one of us has a wife. Ask them. They'll probably be able to give you a list of the things that we don't do right. It's amazing we've survived up until this age. And I say that kind of jokingly, but the truth is, none of us are perfect. Therefore, you have to check on us on what we're saying, because Scripture is the authority, not us. In fact, if you ever go into a place and the person who's leading the church is acting like they're infallible, run. It all goes down to how we look at Scripture. I don't usually use these big words. Exegesis and eisegesis. Exegesis is very simple. We look at Scripture and let Scripture define itself by the context of how it is written and where it is written in the context of all the Bible. So you look at the context of where this verse falls in the chapter, where the chapter falls in the book, where the book falls in the theme from Genesis to Revelation. And you let it dictate it. Eisegesis basically means I would look at Scripture and I would let my own personal feelings, thoughts, and everything influence how I look at that Scripture, which means I can take anything. And because I feel it, that's how I'm going to say it applies. I'll be honest with you. I looked this week. There was a video that came up in something that I was going for. And this guy took a verse that I didn't even think you could take out of context. And he took it so far out of context that he not only went against the rest of Scripture, but then he began to apply it and tell people that they weren't applying it this way, that they were wrong and would go to hell for it. And I'm sitting there going, what? We cannot let our views of Scripture be dictated to by culture. We have to let Scripture dictate to us how we see culture. It can't be the other way around. And that's why we need to be rooted and built up. Because if we're not rooted and built up, guess what? We're going to go down those tangents. And that's how you end up having these cults that begin. And you sit there and you see what people begin to believe. And the reason they believe it is because they've not looked at what it says. Because these cult leaders have sprinkled on a little bit of truth and then taken it way off. And nobody checked up on them. Christ is the center point for a reason. Christ is the one that we have to sit there and focus on completely. Let me ask you a question. When was the last time you went to IKEA and bought a couch and then went home and looked at the directions and thought, no, I feel that this wants to be a table? But that's what eisegesis breaks down to. No, when you look at it, you have to sit there and go, this is what it was made for. This is the context it was made for. This is what I'm going to do. We let Scripture dictate how Scripture is viewed, not the other way around. I knew somebody one time, when it talks about speaking the truth in love, there's a right way and a wrong way. And the right way is when we look at Scripture, we see what love is defined as. So if someone says, you know, when it says speak the truth in love, that doesn't mean we can blast a brother or a sister and then say, well, the only reason I said that is because I love you. No. If it doesn't match up with the rest of Scripture, we're not doing it right. And this is so important because if we follow our feelings, we'll end up way off the map. But if we follow Christ, we don't have to look any further. The next part, it says this. For in Christ, all the fullness and deity lives in bodily form. And in Christ, you have been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority. The reason he's having to say this is because the Gnostics had told them, no, you know what? Christ didn't really come in bodily form. He was this kind of spirit. And the people who saw him didn't really know what they were seeing. Time and time again, Jesus proved that he was in bodily form. When he would sit down and eat with people and drink with people, when he invited them to touch his nail-scarred hands and feet and side, he was proving that he was there in bodily form. And so he's sitting there going, look, not only was Jesus full in his deity, but he was also full in bodily form. And he goes through and he begins to talk about being circumcised and uncircumcised as far dealing with our hearts, not a physical body part. He's talking about the old self and the new self, the old nature, sin nature, and what we have in Christ. And it's so key for us to remember this, because so many times I think we feel like we're lacking because we forget who we have in Christ and what we have in Christ. Now, I'm about to do something, and I hope I've filled the level up right. See, the wonderful thing about Jesus is he had to deal with the laws of physics, but he could change them if he felt like it. Me, I don't have that problem. So when we look at this vase, and we have this cup, pretend this cup is us. Is there anything in this cup? You sure? How do you know? Because you can see it, and you can see that it's upside down. But see, in Christ, he has all his fullness, and he's willing to give it to us. Okay, so as we go down into Christ, this is where it gets tricky. All of a sudden, are we still empty? Are we empty or are we full? Because of the glass? Because of what?
Content.
Because of the content of what Christ has. Now, in a perfect world, like I said, the laws of physics, this thing would still be completely full. Just ignore that part. Okay? But this is what we have. Once we're in Christ, we're full, because he is our fullness. He has the fullness that God has given him. And what we see is that it doesn't matter. If I pull that glass back up, is it still going to be full? Yes. Why? Because of Christ. And the cool thing is this. When we get to heaven one day, and God looks at us, what's he going to see? He's going to see the fullness of Christ in us, not us. Thankfully, he sees that. Thankfully, he sees his son and what his son has done for us. Which is why we have to keep him at the center point, and why we need to be rooted and built up in him. So as we're going through our weeks, when we face discouragement, when we feel like we've been beaten down, when we feel like we're adrift, we have to remember, where is our fullness coming from? Is it coming from our self-worth at the time? Our feelings will come and go. Our emotions will change. But Christ does not change. His fullness remains from start to finish. And when we accept him as our Savior, we have his fullness in us. And it's not because of anything that we have done. It's not because of anything that we deserve. It's not because of anything we can earn. It's simply because of him. That sounds like the source I want to be connected to. When he says he'll never leave us or forsake us, that is a promise that we can rest in. When it talks about having the joy of the Lord, that's not dependent on the circumstances. It's in spite of the circumstances. So for me, a lot of times it goes back to my health and the different things with my diabetes and different things like that. And it can drain me and make me feel down. For you, it may be some totally different area. It may be a struggle that you've been having, or maybe a circumstance that your family's going through, or maybe whatever it may be. But the beautiful thing is, Christ is the same for all of us. He provides fullness in him for all of us. And at that moment when we accept Jesus as our Savior, he seals us and he takes off that old nature from us, throws it to the side, and all we have is this sparkling new thing, and it's all because of him. Because of his amazing love. Because he is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And because of the sacrifice that he chose to do when he... When God sent his son Jesus down to the world, it says that he laid his life down and he took it back up again. Maybe you're here today and you're going, you know, you're talking about being in Christ and stuff like that, and I don't know if I've ever done that. I don't know if I've ever made that choice. Come and talk to one of us. We'd love to have a chat about it. We'd love to be able to discuss what it means to be in Christ, what it means to have that assurance in him. Every Wednesday night, both in person and online, we have our growth groups. And we talk things through and kind of discuss, and it's a time where we can encourage you to go a little bit deeper into what the passage is talking about. You say, well, I don't know. I don't know if I feel comfortable. Come to the online group. Don't turn on your camera. We have lots of people who don't like turning on their camera. That's fine. Even if you just want to come and listen to hear what's going on, feel free. But don't keep going without asking questions. Maybe you ask one question and we answer it as best we can, and another question comes up. Great, we'll talk about that one too. There's no quota that you have to, like, okay, sorry, you've reached your question limit. No more answers, sorry. It's not going to happen. Because we want everybody to have that assurance and that fulfillment and fullness that we have in Christ. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you give us your fullness in yourself. Lord, we thank you that you are the great I am. We thank you for the fact that you love us. Lord, I thank you for the fact that you don't make us try to earn our salvation, because, Lord, the truth is we would never be able to get there. Thank you for the mercy that you show us, the grace that you show us, the love that you show us on a daily basis. Lord, when we allow our roots to start going to the wrong sources, Lord, please point it out to us so that way we can grow our roots down deep into you. As we pursue you and then walk in you, we read your word and we pray and we have that conversation time together. Lord, help us to stay consistent in that. Lord, we pray for stronger relationships in our church body. Lord, that we would, if there's somebody here that's like, you know, I don't exactly know how to start that whole thing, Lord, just give everybody a boldness to be able to just find somebody that they can then begin to study with or walk with in ministry. Lord, you've already done so much for Abbeywood Community Church. Lord, we just pray that you would continue to help us grow, Lord, in numbers. Help us to grow in our relationships. Help us to grow in our relationship with you. Lord, help us to be able to be a light that shines in our community, Lord, where people can come to know you as their Savior. Lord, we are a group of imperfect people. We have a perfect Savior. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you so much for this words of encouragement and uplift. We want to close, we'll take this final song that says, "You are my King." And just talk about this amazing love that we have in Jesus. And bless us. Please.
You are content. I know I'm not.
Saturday, 15th of October, is when the whole thing will happen in terms of the service, the burial and everything. And it's going to take place at the Slade in Plumstead at 11 o'clock. For as many who can make it, all will come there. It's Saturday, 11 o'clock. And on Wednesday, the online group meets and the in-person meets still at your place. Yeah. If you want to know more about that, just ask. Any of the three leaders, Jeff, Ryan, and Chris, and they can put you on the WhatsApp group. Thank you so much. Thank you for coming.